to talk about today is this home sleep testing. And I'm not going to be comprehensive, complete. I was able to garner some other talks by Nancy Collip and by other people that go into the weeds on all sorts of things. And while we may need to go into the weeds as specialists, today I just thought about, I thought I'd talk about my perspective on home sleep testing and where and how it has fit into the practice. So home sleep testing fits into this thing about assessment and testing. And when people talk about it, they always talk about the idea that, oh, it's the test, it's the test, it's the test. And obviously it's not. It's your assessment, it's your pretest probability, it's your population that you're testing. It's the sort of things that you sort of look at in your reading of the reasons for having a test that tell you a lot about what to expect. But the more important thing on any test is outcome. I mean, do you make a decision on it that makes a difference to the patient? Not necessarily makes a difference to you or to your bottom line or to whatever it is, but does it really make a difference to the patient? So I don't have any relevant to this particular talk. Inspire, Research Awards, Galvani, Symmetrics, Seven Dreamers. So the objectives are to list the range of diagnostic tests and their elements, describe the test characteristics of home sleep testing, and consider HST in the broader context of outcome and value. And I'm going to emphasize the application of clinically tested devices, and I'll not address the wannabes and the wearables. So the what ifs we can talk about, but we can talk about at the end, but the major thing on anything, your wristwatch or your newest Fitbit or your Apple Watch or whatever it is going to be tested, at least in terms of sleep medicine. It should be understood in the context of a diagnostic test, not as a health fitness test. I mean, anybody can take their pulse and say if it's fast or slow. It's just how do you act on it and does it make a difference? And sorry, adults only. And there's a recent editorial by Ross and Redline about portable testing in children. I think that doesn't necessarily have different principles, but it certainly does not have a very strong database. So a brief history here. So in 1950, sleep and its stages, the technology was developed. It was really an extension of seizure monitoring in the 50s that then brought the cardiorespiratory measures. And in 1972, the term polysomnography was created by Dement because he had to talk to the insurance companies and he wanted to get it reimbursed. So he just made up a name. That's all he did. He said, I just made it up for that reason. And in 1981, in a study of all the sleep centers that were done, which at that time was something like 9 sleep centers in the United States, 12% of all tests were for impotency with PNL tumescence testing. That's interesting. Okay. 1981, ASDA, which is now the AASM, testing and certification. 1990, International Classification of Sleep Disorders had 83 disorders in 4 symptom categories. Pretty convenient: hypersomnolence, insomnia, parasomnia, and disorders in medical, neurological, and psychiatric disorders. It was really symptom-based. And in the ICD-3, ICD-2, and then now ICD-3 is much more diagnostic criteria based. So in 1972, this guy, Neonkodin, while measuring cardiac output with dye, rediscovered wavelength comparisons to measure oxygen saturation. He did it with Minolta and then with Nellcor. And he just recently passed away and was hailed in Japan as a real hero. So the oximeter was made that could be simple. Before that, these oximeters, the Hewlett-Packard ear oximeter, had 8 wavelengths. It was about the size of a deck of cards. You strapped it on the head over the ear. And that's what was going on when I was there in 1976 and 78. That's what sleep studies were being done. But by 1981, it was the Nellcor. In 1978, Flinley used a continuous oximetry in a patient with COPD and showed enormous falls in oxygen saturation, particularly during rapid eye movement sleep. It was published in the Lancet. He had a worldwide speaking tour as a result of that one figure. And it was built on the idea that Dr. Robbins in the 1950s as a fellow measured blood gases during sleep in COPD patients. He would be in the room with a blood gas syringe with a 19 gauge needle in it, heparin lubricated glass syringe, and he could draw blood gases without waking up the patient. So then Flinley showed you could do it with oximetry. And oximetry, while it wasn't as accurate as a saturation, it was plus or minus 2%, and still is about plus or minus 2%. The fact that you could get 8 hours of continuous data gave you some ideas of trending. We used oximetry, Michael Decker and I, 1988 to 82 in a variety of conditions, heart failure, COPD with oxygen, neuromuscular disease, quadriplegics, and we deployed it using a homemade battery-powered Criticare oximeter attached to an Oxford monitoring tape recorder. And it gave us ideas that sleep apnea was not confined to the usual hours of polysomnography. In fact, we proposed at one point that severity was really a case of whether or not you fell asleep during the day and had your apneas. We also showed diurnal rhythm in oxygen saturation in heart failure patients, and that was improved in a randomized controlled trial that used lisinopril. EdenTrace was the first portable monitor, came out of Minnesota, and Ed Schuck deployed that across the country, tried to sell it to people, and sleep labs didn't want it. They said, why do that? We already are doing 4, 5, 6 PSGs a week. Why do we need that one of those things? And he said, well, you can do more people. And he was a visionary. He's passed away. But 4 machines fell off the truck in Cleveland and literally did. He dropped them off and said, use them. And Susan Redline used them in the Cleveland Sleep Family Study as the initial recordings of portable monitoring, and this was, and everyone, you could see what every criticism was when she presented it was, well, you didn't do sleep studies, and she said, well, you know, give me the money and I'll do it. Well, eventually she got money with the sleep heart health study. But it was very interesting that they said, well, it couldn't work, it's too noisy, you wouldn't be able to deploy it. And she studied a total of about 50 families in Cleveland. I'm not sure exactly what number it was. But portable monitoring with the EdenTrace was so bad that she could actually estimate the heritability of sleep apnea in Cleveland, which was about 40%. Now, it didn't tell you why they had heritable sleep apnea. Could be because they were heavy, obese, jaw structure, whatever it was, but it's good enough, since all variation is genetic versus environmental, and any noise from the monitor would be environmental. The fact that she could detect 40% genetic signal in this is really a testament. All right, so HSTs are a diagnostic test, and I was very interested in this and still am. And Harold Socks, I reviewed some of my work. Diagnostic tests are not tested the same as therapeutics. In therapeutics, you sit there with a double-blind placebo-controlled trial and you do this, that, or the other. You can't really blind diagnostic tests to the individual being tested or to the person doing the testing. You can blind the results, maybe, but you can't blind that. So they have to be assessed by 4 different criteria. None have to be perfect, But failure to assess these things in these four domains, he said, was very important. First, it had to be biologically and physiologically plausible. So that you had to have some basis for why this should be measured and that you could measure it. It had to be feasible in terms of patient acceptance. I mean, if you had to do a brain biopsy for a diagnostic test, that would have a different sort of sense of feasibility than oximetry overnight for COPD. But on the other hand, you had to be able to know how feasible it was and could you do it. Was it reliable? That is, its sensitivity and specificity and likelihood ratios. You didn't have to know everything, but how well did it operate in different settings? Choosing just one setting, say in a hospital or a sleep lab or a nursing home or a children's or a daycare center or a pulmonary clinic was fine to start with, but not necessarily to give you the idea of how it could be deployed. And finally, it had to have a role in clinical decision-making. That is, in making an outcome. Now, that's the one that most of the people, most of the wearables and the wannabes and all that sort of stuff fall down. They go, well, why? Doctors know how to, they know automatically how to interpret tests. But that's not the case. And today, what's also added is the concept of value. How much does it cost to buy? How much does it cost to deploy? Who will pay for it? And is there some competitive edge? So you keep that in mind, that when anyone pitches you a new device or a new way of doing things, that there are sort of principles of diagnostic testing. Because what you have is, in the terms of AHI, you want to be able to get the true positives from the false positives from the true negatives. And you want to be able to get those sorts of things under control. So imagine you had a test and the overlap was enormous. It could be sold. It might be really cheap. And it might be useful to use under some circumstances, sort of like this rapid testing for COVID. But it has sufficient overlap in these things. So you can imagine that these devices came on the market at that time, and the Eden Trace itself had a slow going if it had the traction was there. And that's why Chuck dropped these off, just to be able to have people excited about it. So the testing for sleep apnea. All right. 1994, they had level one, level two, level three, and level four. Level one is an attended PSG. We know what that is. We interpret those all the time. Level two is an unattended PSG. And you say, what is that? Well, a technician in the Sleep Heart Health took a CompuMedix machine that was originally designed for the laboratory, went out to the house, monitored the person, put all the stuff on their head and on their chest and on their legs and on everything else, said thank you very much, and came back the next day and picked it up. There was no iterative process to be able to check your leads. There was no hands off. And it turned out to be about 9% of the records couldn't be scored, but that's not bad. It turns out to be about 8% of the records can't be scored now. But that was the basis of the Sleep Heart Health study. So when the Sleep Heart Health presents their PSG data, they're talking about level two monitoring. There's level three, which is a mixed portable apnea testing, and then level four, which continues single or dual bioparameter. Usually oxygen saturation, maybe also flow, maybe chest movement. Now, you know, that was 1994, and people emphasized that these are the sort of the portable monitoring to be deployed at home. These are level two, threes, and level four. And why four? Well, it's bigger than three, and it's smaller than 18. I mean, you know, it's that's really how it came about. So types one and two, we know that. This box that you show up there that's done in a level attended, this box is worn on the chest in an unattended level two device. types 1 and 2 give you this sort of data. This is an example of a telefactor GRAS recording with EEG, EMG, chin levels, right leg, left leg, and then you have EKG, snore signal, thermistor flow, chest wall, ribcage, abdominal motion, some degree of saturation change back and forth, and various sorts of things. Okay, so what do you do? So it was very simple. You sit there and you take out all those signals, and voila, you have a type 3 monitor. So that's really where it came from. This is how it, with the 1980s, this is what Eden Trace and what Ed Schuck realized. And you had this sort of thing. Now we call it type 3. We call it different things. We call it even more names than that. So the type 3 has usually airflow, effort, oximetry, ECG, and position. The WatchPat uses a little different kind of algorithm. You say, why is it in there? Well, a lot of people studied it. A lot of people thought it was good and still is, and it's reasonable. And it was tested in all 4 domains. And people sort of knew how it was deployed, and they thought that it distinguished itself from the pack by the ability to measure autonomic nervous activity like sympathetic and parasympathetic activity, whether that's useful for you in deciding whether to treat a patient is not really that clear. Type 4 oximetry is a heart rate, usually positio. And then home oxygen testing. It's interesting that today the CMS will permit the portable monitoring for overnight cardiopulmonary recordings, but it will only accept overnight oximetry for the prescription of home oxygen at night. So if you make a mistake, you do portable type 3s, you say, oh, they're pretty hypoxic, all they need is oxygen, you've got to repeat the study. All right. So in 2005 and 2007, the initial studies of oximetry were pretty good. Whitelaw et al. And Mulgrew et al. Both looked at oximetry by itself against PSG, a level 4 versus a level 1. And they had different sorts of things, but the things they had in common was that they kind of randomized the patients. Some had larger. There was a lot at that time, there was a lot of people that were excluded, mainly because you didn't have a lot of healthy people that were coming into the sleep labs. I mean, you didn't have this knowledge we have now that's out there in the community that anybody whose wife says that they snores gets an HST, or anybody that says their spouse snores, or their diabetic snores, or their person that have heart trouble snores, or they don't snore, or whatever it is. But they whittled it down to where it was. And they considered those eligible, and they completed the trial. And that was hard because the big push was for PSG. And they found no difference in CPAP compliance, and they found no difference in their quality of life scores at either 6 weeks or 3 months. Okay, let's show an example for that. On the left is compliance using AHI, which is the PSG measurement of respiratory events during sleep, or the RDI, the respiratory disturbance index, because in an oximeter or even a level 3 device, you don't generally measure sleep directly. The area under the curve in terms of the adherence was no different. And in the Mulgrew study, it was a little bit better if you use portable, but it wasn't statistically so. They thought that maybe because you were treating them or diagnosing them at home, you then treated them at home, they kind of understood what this was all about better than if you brought them into a specialized laboratory. There were studies that suggested that people coming into the laboratory felt more comfortable or less uncertain about how they were being tested than if they did it at home. But those things were not thought to be particularly useful. Now, quality of life, which is fairly important. So remember, that's it, outcome. And what do we do with CPAP? And CPAP was the major way of doing it. What can we really affect we can get them on therapy is often it's quality of life. It's blood pressure and quality of life. Less sleepiness, less snoring, less disruption of the family, and less daytime fatigue. And so these were the prediction categories by physician. So before you would do the test, you would predict sort of, would they be better in 3 months? That's a pretty good exercise. Probably we should add that to any of our assessments for sleep apnea, particularly the new ones. Or we should advocate people in the primary care to predict, well, do they think this person's going to be better in 3 months? And you can see that the more likely you were for is the one that they thought 75 to 100% sure that they would be they would be better. Three is 50 to 75. Two is 25 to 50. And one is less than 25%. Now, people came in, they snored, they were sleepy, they had a physician examination. They had what's called a squally, which is out of Canada. But it's really, it could be stop bang, it could be a Berlin questionnaire, it could be any sort of pre-test probability, you make a decision, and sure enough. Now, it made no difference as to whether or not they had portable or PSG, and it also made no difference in terms of their change in their squally, which is the sleep apnea quality of life index. SAQLI. So now we have out-of-center testing and the AAS. I mean, you can't imagine the heartburn this portable monitoring. It was going to undercut the entire business model. It was going to be just, we need to understand this. So one of the ways you can do that is you can sort of create categories and get people together to talk about these particular tests. So they wanted to evaluate the available technology that was being sold by door-to-door salesmen generally to practices, including primary care practices, because you knew it took so long to get polysomnography. Now, it didn't say you can make a better decision. It didn't say the patient would get better. It just took so long to get polysomnography. So they have the scoper categorization table. So each machine is looked at for whether or not it measures sleep and how it measures sleep. It's looked at for whether or not it does a cardiovascular monitor, oximetry, position, effort, respiratory flow at the nose and mouth. It's called the scoper categorization signal. And each of these have various levels of sophistication. And the ones that are the PSG are the kind of the highest level, the top rows across. But as you can see at the bottom, there's another cardiac measure or there's another respiratory measure. So the one at the bottom, the row at the bottom is oximetry with heart rate. The one at the top is PSG. And now you've got 1, 2, 3. You make all these decisions as to what you do. So an example. Here is from our sleep view scene, but in 2012, CMS said, we're going to use portable monitoring because we're going to save lots of money. Well, before that, there had been an anecdotal study published really almost as a letter from Kaiser System in Seattle. I'll remember the name, but they used portable monitoring versus PSG to set up a system because they found that their PSG costs were like 10 times greater in terms of the number of tests they were doing and the cost of those tests than any other test in their system. Ed Schuck saw this when he was at a meeting and called me up from Hawaii to tell me about that, and I still have the copy of the presentation, and they could show that they could slow the number of PSGs if they did portable monitoring, and they still could make a difference. Now, at that time, titration of CPAP at home was you gave them a machine, you told them how to increase the pressure, you set it at 6, and you call them up in 2 days, and they say, I'm still snoring, and they say, increase in another centimeter of water. And 2 days later, you call them up again, and usually they or their spouse could be able to increase the pressure. And they found that, yeah, they could remotely monitor patients, remotely do this pretty well in a system. It took supervising doc, it took three respiratory therapists, and they had about 350,000 covered lives. Now, all they took care of was sleep apnea, but that was what they did. So scoper level three, this is a 2018 one, two, many, many of these things came out. And if you suggest that these devices are pretty easy to make, they might be easy to make, then you have to think of the cost of the device, which is between sold to you for the princely sum of between $1,500 and $4,000. Whether it's usable or not, there's now one reusable one, one disposable one, but you could reuse these things. And you have all these signals, and they're pretty small, and they get placed on the head, they get placed on all sorts of things. And then you kind of put them head to head, as the Scoper article did, to be able to see whether or not they made a difference in terms of making an RDI measurement that you would have that you could make a decision on. And you found that there were several of them that didn't. Well, those people are out of the marketplace, right? And then you had another bunch of people that sort of had the okay. Fortunately, our sleep view had the okay. But when you can sit there and say, okay, I can make these things, I can do these things, I can figure them out, I can compare them to PSGs, I can do those sorts of things. The cost of the development, of the testing, of the deployment, just getting it to market is around $8 million. So right there, you see that there are about seven systems that no longer are around that had some investment in it into the marketplace. So we're going to go on a little bit to know the deployment. This is the VA data set, and the VA data set is important because it's the largest managed care system in the world. And this data I'm going to show you is from Sam Kuna. People have seen it, I'm sure, but I'll just take my take on it. This is the number of PSGs and home sleep testing done, whatever device, whatever thing you do in the VA. 2012 was when there was a CMS and you could use it. Now the VA doesn't care whether or not CMS reimburses the VA for portable testing. But it's just a kind of a benchmark to kind of know where the rest of the world in the United States is starting to say, oh, maybe I can charge for this. What you can see is that over the last few years, and now it's crossed and it's gone over, the PSGs have leveled out pretty much, not completely gone away. It has not, in the analogy of today, it has not shown the downtrend. But HSTs are still going up. Now there are several reasons, and you can think of all of them, but one of the ways, the most important thing to remember here is that PSGs have a particular role in management and sleep medicine. And I think we have to think about how we present PSGs to people, when we present them to, so that they understand their value. Home sleep testing certainly is useful, it's deployable, and it can be used for diagnosing the, 70% of people who might benefit from diagnosis, and then of that group, maybe 50% benefit by therapy. So patients with suspected OSA, they had a home sleep study and simultaneous in-lab PSG and portable monitor. So there's this to address the challenges in home sleep testing. If you do a sleep test and you're in the laboratory, you're one thing. And if you do it at home and don't have a PSG there, that's another. Ideally, you would have done it at home with a unattended level 2 PSG to look at whether or not they gave you the same data. But if you would, so that those are addressing the idea that these are different recording devices with different ways of detecting airflow, different environments, and different nights. So these were the ways that they delivered the care. This was the machine they used. I think this is the NOX-3. And what they could show is the PSG, the in-lab portable monitoring, and the PSG give you pretty similar data, but the home monitoring is a little bit different. So lesson 5, they're all pretty good. 5 to 15, they're all pretty good. And then you get higher. So, you know, in some ways, that's not too bad. The only problem is this greater than 15 to less than 30. You know, you're not measuring sleep. And so what is that home sleep test at home kind of showing beautiful results, but the in-lab is there? They talk a little bit about it, but this is the data. The data are what they are. So this is the NOX-3, this is what it is. This is what the percent of time in each of the apneas, or percent, and then each of the apnea categories of each of the groups. And again, you had more severe people that kind of went into the laboratory. So this was the study design, but fortunately, you see at the bottom, it's CPAP adherence and the functional outcomes, and they did some medical care costs, and they went through this study pretty carefully. They looked at really the ability to detect things that were an AHI that were greater than 15, because if they were less than 15, they had to have more evaluation. Functional outcomes of sleep questionnaire at 3 months were similar. So what it is that you can make a decision. Let's go back here for a second. You can make a decision of whether to treat or not treat. You can make a decision whether to offer CPAP or not. You can make a decision, and you don't do so in because of just the test. And if whatever test you use, you can still make a decision. Now, you could say that's predictable, because you could also do the same thing with just a single channel oximetry that Flemons and those guys showed. I mean, it's really the decision making on the test rather than the test itself. Now, what does the test offer you? Well, it offers you cover to be able to go on to the next set of therapy. It offers you excuses on not to treat. It offers you some sort of idea as to whether they have sleep apnea as currently defined, but it also gives you some other things like oxygen saturation and heart rate. But I submit to you that there's been no real study of portable monitoring that is emphasized in those interpretations. Either the oxygen saturation. And indeed, you've seen these things where their AHI is 5, their oxygen saturation is below 90 for 80% of the time, and there's no comment on it. So I think we have some things to think about. I'm going to move on to key elements. So the key elements, remember the population, is the ordering physician's indications for study. Now that it's out there to PCPs, at one time at the VA, even for our consults, we graded the level of consults. We should do that again for portable sleep study. I mean, real auto OSA was a C. B was snoring, may have sleep apnea. And A was snoring, sleepy, unrefreshing sleep, and observed apneas. D was, you know, heart failure. D was whatever it is, no symptoms, no. And you look into the chart and you say, what did they think of? And the note, it says, spouse says that the patient snores. Now, is that enough information to make a real decision? Not really. Is it to make a real decision for the PCP? Not really. So we depend on a patient questionnaire to figure out, and we ask simple questions. We ask the Epworth to see if they have passive sleepiness. We may ask some other things. We don't really want to burden these people with too much, We could do it easier. You could always think of giving them the Pittsburgh Sleep Quality of Life, which is something like, 14 pages? Takes an hour to finish. Okay, next is graphic data, 1 to 3 nights, consolidated data summary and detailed event, study data itself, and last is interpretation and recommendations. That's the output. This is what all the PCPs look at. They look at your interpretation and recommendations. So you've seen them. You've seen them interpreted as being has sleep apnea, use CPAP. Thank you very much. Now we have a template which has expanded every year since I've seen it and is redone. And I don't want to cast aspersions, but you know, to what extent are we being specific and tailoring it to whatever the test is? It's hard because you don't have your pretest probability. You don't know if this person came from if they come from an obesity clinic, they all have sleep apnea. If they come from an anorexic clinic, then maybe 1% has sleep apnea. You don't know whether or not, or if they come from heart or lung or whatever it is, you'd like to have a little more detail than what you have. So the practice guidelines. So what do they suggest from the AASM? Diagnostic testing for OSA should be performed in conjunction with a comprehensive sleep evaluation adequate follow-up. Tended PSG is the gold standard. Clinical tools and questionnaires should not be used to diagnose OSA. So when the Berlin questionnaire came out, insurance companies all called me and said, oh, by the way, can we use this to diagnose sleep apnea and be a lot cheaper? I said, no, it's a pretest probability. The person who called me up, I gave him Harold Sox's name and had him call him. Tended PSG or tended HST with a technically adequate device should be used to diagnose OSA in uncomplicated adult patients. There were people that were taking unattended PSG, rolling out in their truck, setting it up at home and doing that. And there may still be some people. It's a little inefficient, but that was really the nod to the Sleep Heart Health study to say, gee, those were pretty good studies. And we acknowledge that. HST should be one which uses nasal pressure, chest, abdominal rip oximetry, or PAT with oximetry and actigraphy. So that was the nod to the watch PAT. HST should have 4 hours of adequate recording. Why 4 hours? Well, this is a study that came out in 2014, and it was the effect of recording duration and diagnostic accuracy of out-of-center sleep testing. And they had the difference between the time internal and the time in bed. And if you really don't know how long it was that was on or in bed or whatever it is, that 4 hours of recording when a person is sleeping is probably adequate. It gives you a lot of information. It doesn't give you everything. And then it gets to the existential question, which I always like to pose to people, is that would you rather have 4 hours of recording over a portable sleep study or say 4 to 7 hours of recording in a PSG? And everybody goes, PSG. Well, would you rather have 3 nights of 4 hours of recording, so you get 12 hours of data versus whatever you get in the sleep lab. I like the three consecutive nights. CMS got burned because people would do 3 nights of portable study and they charge for three tests, even though the person had the same test at the same home. So they said they put a stop to that. Said we'll pay for 1 night. And so the people who were even that those were deploying it for several nights. Now they sort of split the difference. Now that you have remote taking up of that data goes up to a central processing center. If it doesn't look good, they can leave it on for another night. And you can request for 1 or 2 nights, but usually not 3 nights. But the original portable studies, sleep solution studies were 3 nights. And you get a good number of people that would put it on for 3 nights and you get a great sample. All right, If a single adequate HST is negative or inconclusive, an attended PSG should be performed for the diagnosis of OSA in asymptomatic patients. Strong recommendation. Okay, all right. If a single HST is technically inadequate, an attended study should be performed. Weak. The reason it's weak is because it was maybe inadequate study for some reason, is that you still had to make a decision. And maybe you did it because you just had a hunch rather than you had some degree of certainty. So that idea about before you do a test to estimate how much certainty you had is important. PSG rather than HST should be used for patients with severe cardiopulmonary diagnosis, neuromuscular disease, respiratory muscle impairment, wake or sleep hypoventilation, chronic opioid use for severe insomnia. Well, number seven is not read by the insurance companies. But we should know that that's what it is. And sometimes you just have to roll with it. You do your HST, and then you end up with going to a PSG. The current clinical practice guidelines recommend using polysomnography in patients with COPD and heart failure due to lack of evidence supporting the use of home sleep apnea testing to diagnose OSA patients with comorbid conditions. So these are things I was going to present primarily to the pulmonary people. How do I know the patient's asleep? You don't. How should a purported interpretation be modified if the patient reports using sedative medications or alcohol? Use of sedative represent modifiable risk factors. I don't know. Alcohol and sedative use may also explain the night-to-night variation we observed in OSA. And that was really a quite an interesting little sub-study in which I was interpreting sleep solution recordings from all over the country. As before, they clamped down. You can only interpret them if you had a license in that state. And it was fun to do, but I'd have these ones which had severe night-to-night variation, and I'd call up the referring physician, and I'd ask him, about this, if it was all right if I called his patient, and generally they said yes. And a lot of it was, I had a drink that night, or it was Saturday and Sunday and Monday, or it was Friday, Saturday and Sunday, or Thursday, Friday, Saturday, or things of that sort. There's that. What about positional related OSA? And at that time, they didn't have position. Now they have position, but clues where you would have these stretches of apneas, which would not resemble the 90-minute cycles of REM. And if you had pretty bad sleep apnea, it generally would not obscure your decision. Nowadays, now that we have position, we can tell them to avoid their supine position or their left lateral or whatever it is. That had less events. All right, now I have a few cases that I wanted to go through and I wanted to present to you because I wanted to learn how to kind of present these to the pulmonary critical care people. I can stop here though with some questions, and maybe that's useful because some people might not be as interested in this as before. Any questions up to this point?
Kingman?
Mm-hmm.
I have a question. I'm just curious, how often do you have someone up, come by peddling a device?
I'm sorry, what the device?
Well, how often do you have someone stopping by to peddle?
It used to be all the time.
Really? Huh.
And what you find out in the hinterlands out there,
uh-huh,
is that while we now are trying to offer one particular device called SleepView that we can interpret and therefore we can deploy it and we know what they are and we know what it is to all our primary care physicians, that in the last 8 years, the opportunity cost by not having portable monitoring has meant that all these companies will come in and they'll give a presentation. And they'll whisper to them, they'll say, those guys up there at the academic center really aren't out for your interest because it takes them long time to do a PSG, and we can give you results in 2 weeks.
Huh.
And so now we're competing against companies who have had 6, 7, 8 years of getting results back pretty quickly. They have hired physicians who actually sit at home in their jammies and are supposed to interpret about 20 of these per hour. And you wonder how good their interpretations are.
Huh.
You wonder about how good the interpretations are. And I'd like to do a study here, and I'm going to be talking to SleepView about it, in which we can have 6 of our docs here interpret the same study and see if they get, see if they make the same recommendations, if they do the same thing. Now it's a bit constraining because we have a interpretation template that we generally use, but it's always interesting to sort of see what people will pick up.
Hmm.
But and nowadays it's gone on to wearables. You know, the patient will come in, they'll say, gee, you know, my watch tells me I'm sick. I snore. I got snore sat. I got my oxygen saturation. I woke up and it was 88%. Oh my God. And you go, well, you just meant that you dreamt you were going to Vail to ski. That's all. So then you have to go back and take a history. See, they forget that you have to actually take a history.
Hmm.
Because on the other hand, we've got the sleep docs sitting there saying everybody who has a BMI greater than 33, has a stop bang of snores, have tired during the day, and maybe they shouldn't even have an operation until they get tested, right? And then you got the PCP. So it depends on their interest and their what they have. I don't know what proportion of primary care providers in our UH system actually have ordered these things and how many order it frequently. It would be a nice distribution to know.
Thanks.
Kingman, this is Dennis. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yep.
So one other thing in the task force that we did emphasize, which is, you know, is a growing area that the ASN has emphasized, was also patient preference. So obviously a lot of, as you already mentioned, a lot of the testing is predetermined by insurance companies in terms of what type of test patients can get. But in patients who are good candidates for home studies and their insurance may allow either, we often present with them the options of getting doing it either in the home or in the lab, and with the caveats of both. And it's interesting in that, you know, some patients clearly prefer doing it at home, and I've had a number of patients who clearly prefer coming into the lab to have a study done.
The primary care practitioner, who in general is ordering about 70% of all our portable monitoring in the UH system, doesn't even think about that.
Oh, sure. Yeah, they would.
And so as a result, then we don't have that information, or we have that particular discussion that's available when we interpret it. What I'm worried about is really the interpretation of the study and the adequacy of the information you get to begin with, and then the reliability of that across different providers, across different systems, like we did with the oximetry stuff.
Yeah.
Because I think that if it doesn't matter what test it is, a choice is fine. I mean, we don't have any data to say that one in the otherwise uncomplicated patient.
Right.
You know, and it'd be nice to do a modern study, with all the knowledge and experience and the Harold Sox people and diagnostic testing and likelihood ratios and things of that sort. You could individualize people where they come from and what they do and how they do it.
Yeah, sure. No, that would be very interesting to look at.
Oh, it's John Carter here. A quick question for you, Kingman. You know, picking up on your point of, redoing a modern study and thinking about two factors. One, the role of the ability to detect sleep disruption and arousals on home-based sleep testing, which we've got at least one device in widespread clinical use that purports to be able to do that, being the PAT-based tests. as well as the kind of growing recognition of these different sleep apnea phenotypes, the arousal phenotype, the high arousal threshold desaturation phenotype, that kind of thing. Not that any of this has been officially worked out yet, but and then secondly, knowing that a lot of these quote unquote validation studies were done, you know, primarily in that 4% no arousal era, not exclusively, but primarily. You know, one wonders about, you know, a broad class of people with a certain specific phenotype of apnea, namely the arousal phenotype, that we're really under or misdiagnosing with home-based testing. And I'm just kind of curious about your thoughts there.
Well, I think there are a couple things that come to mind. Is I don't think that the home sleep testing is not for specialists. So what you're sitting there is saying, okay, I'm a specialist. I know everything under the sun. If I had everything, I'd have 128 electrode array on the head. I'd be able to have near infrared oximetry of the brain. I'd be able to have PET scanning on demand for insomnia patients. And I'd be able to do that sort of stuff. So I think the idea of where this is, the analogy is the gold standard in taking care of coronary artery disease is cardiac catheterization. And so the coronary artery, the cardiologists, when they first heard about things like a stress amoebae and the radiology doing something, they just went nuts until they realized that they actually had more people referred to them with all these equivocal studies and with all these equivocal things going on. Now, on the other side is in talking to Wellman and in hearing what they're thinking about for doing phenotyping, they think they can do it with the airflow and with one lead of the EEG. And you go, what? And they have a pretty good argument for that if you wanted to deploy that to the masses. But the problem is getting a reliable airflow. And you see that even in the portables, you know, they drop off, they look attenuated, they do flow limitation, they do this. But if you had an EEG that showed arousal, you'd be able to look at the time between arousals. If you had a flow, you'd be able to look at what kind of flow profiles you had that would be obstruction versus that. And so it's really a question of kind of like do you want to be able to identify that there are trees there? And then do you want to go in and see what those trees are? I mean, to what extent do you want to be a botanist or a geneticist for trying to find things? And so my particular approach here has always been that it's the decision making. And we often let the exception drive the rule. And and not that that's there. I know the 4% is there and 3% is there and those sorts of things are there, but we probably need to be, thinking about the home sleep testing, I'm really trying to kind of understand how to put our arms around this as it's currently deployed. And there are people that are going to bring out all sorts of things. And since you see the back was broken in 1993, when you could take a PSG, you could put it on somebody's chest, you could take it to their house, and you could actually measure them overnight, pick it up, and then interpret it like you would a PSG in the sleep heart health study. And you could do that, and you could rinse and repeat 4,000 times. So that told you, whatever you could do. So that's my looking at what it is here. And I've interpreted, I've got examples of interpretations of all sorts of home sleep testing. And I think the x-axis is oxygen saturation. I think if you had an ODI-4, ODI-3, and you had percent time below an oxygen saturation of 90, that you'd be 80% of the way there. And then it's a question of why. So if the oxygen saturation is 94 to 98% for the entire night, it doesn't make too many dips, and it's okay. You sit there and say, what do I care what the airflow is? On the other hand, if I have all sorts of things going on, I'd like to know why, right? And then the sorts of things you can get out of a oxygen saturation is the resat, you know, the resat for centrals versus obstruction. And then if you had flow and you had flow and you had oxygen saturation, you'd also get your circulation time. I mean, I think that there is also I don't do it, but I've worked with these people who are these computer engineering people to be able to dig out information for the oxygen saturation signal and be able to do it in a way that you would say, I want to know the mechanisms. And that's what you're saying. I want to know the mechanisms of what's going on in that patient. Is it because of reduced drive? Is there, and whatever it is. I that's how I interpret your question, John. Does that make sense?
I think it does. I mean, the operative sentence there, I think, at least in my reception of your answer, is the exception driving the rule. And we do need to be cognizant of the overwhelming sort of tsunami of undiagnosed OSA out there that is the rule and not the exception. And these tests are probably perfectly suitable. But again, I mean, in all of our practices, we have been bombarded by plenty of exceptions, you know, folks right. who don't meet one criteria.
And we're going to see, that's why the cardiologists, when they first heard about this portable monitoring stuff and heard that the AASM was against it because it was, not the gold standard and all that, they just laughed. They said, you're going to blow out the bank with these things. Because you can see, and I didn't make a, I've done it before, but if you did, say you did 10 polysomnograms and they cost 1,000 ducats, right? And that would be 10,000 ducats. And then you had 10 PSGs and they cost a half a ducat, right? and so you'd have that many. Well, if you had to do all the, you had to do you had to do all 10 people with an HST, it's just how many you had to repeat doing a PSG. And the number is really about 60% or 70%. If you have to repeat more than that, you know, in a system, you lose money. And we're repeating stuff a lot. I mean, not repeating. We a lot of it converted to PSGs in one way or the other. And we try to respond by doing split nights to say, oh, that's one night rather than two nights. But that didn't work. the HSTs came ahead. And I think it's because that's it. And we're also, I know, you know, sitting at University Hospitals Case Medical Center, sitting in a sleep center is a lot different than sitting out there at Chagrin or out at, you know, where Eileen is, or you know, or where Marvin is, and even Parma. I think it's a different crowd, and that's your likelihood ratio. If you're sitting in the middle of a neuromuscular clinic, maybe you deploy it to be able to convince people they need to be studied. At one point, when it was paid for, people out on the east side of Cleveland were using it as a loss leader. They would do the HST just to get them into the PSG lab, because they would at least give them results, and they give them the primary care results. So the business model you can think of is inventive, and at the end of the PSG era, where it was very lucrative, you had family practitioners having PSG labs in the back of, in Oklahoma, in the back of a gas station.
Those were the days.
Going to the masses, right? Sleep apnea for the masses. Well, I think we probably should stop here, and I'm gonna go over these cases with the fellows in the next hour, and we're gonna talk about what they look like. But I think there are three outcomes to an interpretation. One is sort of the slam dunk. That is, they've got it, they have it, they have what it is. Number two is maybe, maybe not. I don't know what it is. And the third is they don't have it, but they got something you got to worry about. And that's the ones in which you go back there and you say, no sleep apnea. Oxygen is okay. They don't have sleep apnea in the primary care, but you have to watch out for hypersomnolence syndromes or restless legs or whatever it is that's there. And those are the ones you get a call back from your primary care practitioner to say, I thought this was a sleep apnea test. What are you telling me all about this? And you go, that's because they probably have narcolepsy. So true, true, and unrelated. Snoring and sleepy, but unrelated. And then the oxygen saturation stuff, I think, is important too. But... all right. Thank you, people. Go out and vote, and it's going to be an interesting day.